it when I was reading her book, Caught, the subtitle of which I forget.
Prison State and the Lockdown of America.
The Lockdown of America, which was submitted for an award thing that I was involved in. I was impressed by the book. And then, as president of the Eastern Sociological Society this past year, I asked an old friend, Bruce Western, to put together an event around the issue of mass incarceration and the consequences of mass incarceration. And he immediately said he would ask Marie, who had been a colleague of his on the National Academy of Sciences panel, studying this issue, an issue very important, I think, influential. So, then I chaired that little panel, I guess, which was in Philadelphia, where of course she teaches at the University of Pennsylvania. And I said, come and give a talk sometime. And she said, well, I'll let you know when I come to New York. And she was coming to New York, and here she is. I should say, my name is John Torpy from the Sociology Department, primarily Sociology of History and Ralph Bunch Institute around the corner. And so I wasn't kind of putting myself in the foreground of this because I think of it particularly as a Ralph Bunch Institute kind of thing, but I also wanted to see this as an opportunity for sociology and political science to work together because obviously it's an issue that transcends certainly that divide. It's not a particular international issue per se. But in any case, on that note, thank you for coming.
Yes.
During a complicated time personally, honoring this commitment, which is really great, and I want to invite you to listen to her talk about dismantling the carceral state. So thanks for coming.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Allison, for also helping out here. And I don't use a lot of technology in the classroom at all, but I have handouts, so it's like the dark ages there. So it doesn't look like what I'm doing is completely random. If we were here 15 years ago and we were talking about mass incarceration, there would be probably a lot of raised eyebrows. And right now, very few people, you know, it's not a strange word anymore, it's become a household word. But reform to reduce the number of people in prison and jail has actually not been dramatic for all the rhetoric that we see talking about now. And I'll talk a little bit later, but we have a very hot district attorney's race in Philadelphia right now, and you listen to all the candidates who are all talking criminal justice reform, they all allege that they've read the new Jim Crow, but you actually scratch them to see how much criminal justice reform is going to happen. It may not be a whole lot, but I'll say more about that later. So what I'd like to do today is to just kind of give us a scorecard on what reform has happened and what reform hasn't happened, and then I want to talk about why it's been so limited so far. And I'm going to look at the two main frameworks, the kind of Michelle Alexander, new Jim Crow framework, and the kind of the elite, right on crime, smart on crime framework. And then I'm going to talk about the policies we need to reduce significantly dismantle the carceral state. And then the most vexing issue, which is obviously the politics that we need to do this. The scorecard is pretty bleak. That the high point for the number of people in prison and jail was in 2008. The latest figures for 2015, we've dropped about 134,000 people out of over 2.1 million people. Most of that, we say, we're decarcerating. Most of that is driven intensely by a few pockets. So as probably a number of you know, California faced this Brown versus Prada decision. So about 39% of that is just driven by California. If you add New Jersey, changes in parole, again, through a lawsuit, a few thousand more account for that, and then changes in the Sentencing Commission, several thousand people have gotten out because the U.S. Sentencing Commission finally drank the Kool-Aid and realized they could do more to get more people out. So about 55% of that drop since the Great Recession has been driven by just these three developments. And obviously, you know, there are a number of New Yorkers here, or honorary New Yorkers, and they say, well, yeah, we dropped in New York, but you dropped pre-2008. So I'm really talking about developments since 2008 to 2015. About 39 states have seen some decrease, but this decrease has been very modest. And about 10, 11 states have either stabilized or we've actually seen increases going on. look at the behavior of police and prosecutors, they've gotten the memo that the war on drugs is waning, but what we're seeing is that arrests continue to be quite high in relationship to the drop in the crime rate. And what we're seeing is that prosecutors are getting more successful and more efficient at filing felonies and successfully prosecuting them and sending people to prison for them. So what we're seeing is that the sentence lengths have been increasing for all drugs, all crimes except drug possession, and time served has been increasing for all crimes except for property crimes. What we're also seeing is that people say, well, we've become more sensible about parole. We're not sending so many people back because of a parole violation, like a dirty urine test or breaking curfew or something like that. Again, if you take California out of the picture, we've actually seen an increase in the number of people being sent back for parole violations, technical parole violations, rather than a decrease. The third area I like to look at is legislation, and to look at legislation at the state level and the federal level. What we've seen at the state level are dozens of states that have bought into this quid pro quo compromise, which is that they will lighten up on non-serious, non-violent, non-sexual offenders, mostly drug offenders. But the quid pro quo in much of that legislation, or shortly before that legislation is passed, or shortly after that legislation is passed, is to make certain things even more strict, and particularly life in prison and life sentences. And that we've seen a proliferation of crimes now that qualify for life sentences, and people are giving those life sentences out. And so we've seen proceeds over at NYU, 30 states now that have lightened up on the non-nons, and at the same time, or nearly the same time, have passed stricter legislation. In Washington, we heard all this talk about the sentencing overhaul, the big Sentencing Reform Act, and that Jeff Sessions stood in the way of that, and that this was this wonderful reform, was going to do a whole lot. Well, it had that reform been passed, it would have, if they successfully petitioned, about 6,500 people would have gotten out of the federal system, out of 200,000 plus, not a whole lot of people. Going forward, fewer people might have gone into the system. And the other significant thing is in the 11th hour, one of the other things that killed it is this poison pill that the right put in about mens rea, which the Department of Justice, the ACLU, a number of civil rights groups, environmental groups got up in arms about, because essentially the argument was it would make it much more difficult to prosecute corporate crime. And I was on a panel at Harvard Law School with Mark Holden, who's the main public policy person for the Koch brothers, and he said on that panel, oh no, we didn't really care about mens rea, and we would have let it go, and other people wanted it could have taken it or not. But the deeper history that we're understanding now is, in fact, that this was very significant for the Koch brothers. They wanted it in, they thought they could slip it in at the last moment, and then the whole thing fell apart. But had it even gone through, it wouldn't have been the sentencing overhaul that the New York Times promised it is. And the other area to think about is, often we talk about mass incarceration, we think about the numbers, how many people are in prison, how many people are in jail. And I think it's very disheartening to not think of this as a qualitative problem, that if we could reduce the number of people in prison and jail back to where that first chart is that I handed out to you, back to where we were in the 70s at that incarceration rate, but if we were back to 150 per 100,000 as opposed to the 700 per 100,000 today, but if we still had the degrading, dehumanizing conditions that we have in many prisons and jails in the United States, then we will have failed in dismantling the carceral state. So on the positive side, what we're seeing is that qualitative conditions are getting more attention than they once did. No better example than right here in New York City with Rikers Island and the campaign by Just Leadership, led by Glenn Martin, many formerly incarcerated people, that has pushed Mayor de Blasio to sort of say he's got this $10 billion plan over a lot of years, but they're at least putting on the map that Rikers Island should be closed. Likewise, Governor Larry Hogan, back in 2005, just very abruptly closed the Baltimore jail, said it was the worst prison in America, and he just shut it down. Solitary confinement is getting much more attention than it had. Many people didn't know it exists. We didn't know how many people were in confinement. That, thanks to work at the Lyman Center at Yale, working with some progressive, and again, it's within that world. I say progressive directors of corrections. You know, it's among, you know, I wouldn't say directors of corrections generally are progressive, but of the directors of corrections, the ones who are progressive within that environment have actually worked with the Lyman program to better understand how many people are in solitary, how did they get in there. And it's also important to say it's kind of a misnomer to even call it solitary confinement. And as many of you know, the cell is probably the size of a wheelchair accessible bathroom. And some of the solitary confinement is actually two people in that space. So you can imagine, I mean, I wouldn't even want to be with my husband year after year in all that really, really tiny space, right? And when the federal government was confronted about this, the former federal head of prison said, well, it's really not solitary confinement. They have a cellmate, right? But what we really mean when we say solitary confinement is administrative segregation, where people are typically locked down 22 hours a day, 23 hours a day, hour out. Thanks to the Lyman report, we now can estimate that about 89,000 to 120,000 people are in solitary confinement at any moment in time. That's a remarkable figure, because if you, again, looking at that chart, our total prison population, oh, I guess that chart is just rates, our total prison population, prison and jail, 4 decades ago was only 200,000 people. So we are at least having about half as many of those people just in solitary confinement. Really, really quite remarkable. If you put it in another perspective, the entire prison population of Japan is 60,000 people. So we may have twice as many of that people just in solitary confinement in the United States. What we are seeing is that, as I said, solitary confinement is becoming a much more public issue. The hunger strikes in California in 2013 and 2015 were very significant in this. You mentioned the National Academy of Sciences committee that I served on with Bruce Western, and it was an otherworldly committee, because I try to stick away from Washington, and whenever I'm in Washington, I feel like my view of what is possible shrinks and shrinks and shrinks. And I'm also very much a solitary scholar, so until I worked on the National Academy of Sciences, I had never co-authored anything with anybody, and suddenly there are 20 or 21 of us who are all going to have to sign off on this thing. But in those meetings, I had on one side of me Jeff Beard, who was then the Director of Corrections of California, and on the other side of me I had Craig Haney, who's one of the leading psychologists and experts in suing prisons about prison conditions. And he and Jeff were in this battle over the prison conditions in California and enforcement of Brown versus Plata. And the position of Jeff Beard has been that, in fact, they were going to make these changes in the California system on solitary confinement, not because of the hunger strike. They were going to do these changes anyway. The evidence is really pretty clear that it was the hunger strike that pushed them, and also the lawsuit that Craig Haney was pushing, that ultimately pushed a settlement, now that we haven't gotten everybody out of solitary confinement, but it's a more transparent, accountable process. When it started in Pelican Bay in Northern California, they counted, Craig Haney counted, that there were 500 people there who'd been in solitary for 10 years or more. So it's really remarkable. One of my favorite books I read recently is Keramet Ryder's 23/7 book, and it's about the development of solitary confinement and the historical and institutional conditions and battles against it. And it's just a fabulous read. I mean, it's really, I don't say that about many academic books, but it's just a great read. So to sum up, that solitary confinement is getting more attention, but we still have a whole lot of people who are in solitary confinement. The other piece of the scorecard is private prisons. I didn't think that the Obama administration would come out and say, we're going to end the contracts. We will not renew contracts for federal private prisons. As many of you know now, Jeff Sessions, Obama said that last summer. The executive order was reversed by the Trump administration and Jeff Sessions. On the rhetoric of reform, people who've done content analysis of newspapers and editorials about reform, what they found is we haven't fundamentally changed how we talk about mass incarceration. that we still talk about reform in terms of saving money. We don't talk about it in terms of human rights, in terms of human dignity. We don't talk about accounting for the human costs of incarceration. And conservatives on the right, Republican conservatives, tend to be quoted a lot more in the major media on these issues than do people on the left. And the final point is that if we have our scorecard, we have yet to reckon with that. What does it mean to be a carceral democracy? I used to use the term carceral state, and now, and I don't use this in my book, but I think we should think of ourselves as a carceral democracy. And it's really an anachronism to talk about just the people who are in prison and jail, those 2 million people, or just the 5 million people on parole and on probation. But in fact, that the penal system has grown so large that it's metastasized to our society, it's corrupting our democratic institutions, our electoral results are off because so many people can't vote. For a number of you familiar with Jeff Monza's work and Chris Ugin's work about the 2000 election and how if people in Florida were permitted to vote, people who had criminal convictions were permitted to vote, you know, you correct for their socioeconomic background, educational levels, et cetera, even correcting for all that, that they would have lower voter turnout, more of them would have voted for Al Gore, overwhelmingly for Al Gore. Florida would have gone to the Democratic camp, and you know, none of us would know what Chads are, except maybe, you know, a country in Africa or something like that. We, you know, for those of us who are researchers, the huge prison population is corrupting our databases, and Bruce Westrom's work was terrific in showing, and I love this, because he still does this, Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton talks about how fabulous the 1990s were for young African-American men and the low unemployment rates. And as Bruce Westrom shows us, well, there's a low unemployment rate for African-American men because it's only low if you don't count all the young African-American men who are in prison and jail. Mm-hmm. And once you actually count those men, then the unemployment was rising for young African-American men in the 90s. It wasn't falling. Likewise, in my own state of Pennsylvania, the last census, the report was that we are reversing trends and we are actually having a out-migration from the cities, from urban areas to rural areas, which the only way that happens is because we're taking lots of people from Philadelphia, convicting them in Philadelphia, and then shipping them off to rural prisons, and so that's distorting our urban migration patterns. We have counties in the western part of the state that now look much more multicultural. They can apply for multicultural grants, all because their African American population is counted there rather than being counted back in. I know you're looking at me like my students look. Like, she makes this stuff up. I don't make it up. It's in the footnotes in the book, but it's true, right? Because we enumerate people, and it's been very contested in the census whether people should be enumerated in their rural areas, or they should be enumerated where they came from, where they were sentenced, right? And so we, you know, since it's popular to quote Frederick Douglass, and some famous people think he's still alive and doing a good job, and since I quote him, he is kind of alive, right? So, but I love, you know, one of my favorite Frederick Douglass quotes, and I know he's not alive, but he says, "No man can put a chain about the ankle of his fellow man without finding the other end fastened about his own neck." And so when we do this reckoning of scorecard, I don't think we've reckoned with that chain that is around all of our necks in so many ways. Given how much rhetoric we've had about reform, why hasn't more happened, right? So we have this Right on Crime Coalition, Smart on Crime group, and it gives you the impression that if we could just put Grover Norquist and Newt Gingrich and Dan Jones and the ACLU, the Vera Institute in the same room, right, that we would get reversal of these policies. And this elite coalition, and the Koch brothers, too, forgot about them. This elite coalition has severe limits. And we're kind of blind to the limits. We think that if we just put everybody in the room, it doesn't really matter what, you know, we don't really look at the policies that are coming out of this. And this, Newt Gingrich was asked about this at a bipartisan summit on criminal justice reform in March of 2015, and the reporter said, "Oh well, you know, how is this any different than comprehensive immigration reform? Everybody thought we'd get comprehensive immigration reform, and it all fell apart." And Newt Gingrich said, "Well, this is fundamentally different than immigration reform. there's a much, much bigger consensus. It's sort of like welfare reform. Well, as many of us know, welfare reform, ending welfare as we know it, meant ending welfare. And it's a bracing reminder that cooperation across the aisle is only as good as the policies that it produces. So why, what's wrong with this coalition? First of all, this coalition is knit together first and foremost by you can save money by criminal justice reform. And the fact is that states don't spend a whole lot of money on criminal justice. That they spend about 2 to 3% of their expenditures. They spend twice as much on highways. Right? So it's a fast-growing portion of the budget, but it's still relatively small, say, compared to healthcare or Medicaid. The monetary savings may not be there. California, one of the big reformers right now, the first budget after the realignment in California, their corrections budget actually went up $1 billion. And their state budget to do reform went up another $1 billion because they were giving incentives to counties to say, look, you're going to take our prisoners from state prisons. You can either build jails or you can develop alternatives to incarceration, and we've got a $1 billion pool for you to do that. So California is a test case, and New York is another case. If you look at your corrections budgets, for all the talk about releasing people, your budgets haven't gone down significantly. The other thing is that framing the carceral state as a fiscal problem feeds into kind of this deficit politics, austerity hysteria. And we just accept that deficit politics is like the sun going up and then coming down and the moon going up at night, and we don't accept that it's very politically constructed. And you don't save money on prisons and jails unless you close prisons and jails and you lay people off. If you just release people from prison, the marginal cost of releasing somebody is very small. So it's like, every time that Penn, let me give you an example of Missouri, the Director of Corrections in Missouri, I said, well, how much does an additional person cost for you when you release someone? This is about $6,000 a year, right? So the average overall might be $40,000 per person who's incarcerated, but if I release someone, I save about $6,000 for toilet paper, for food, et cetera, et cetera. So unless you lay off staff, you close facilities, you're not going to save a whole lot of money. But what we're seeing is with this deficit austerity hysteria, many directors of corrections are under a lot of pressure to show they're saving money, that they're tightly built somehow. So what we're seeing is what I call meaner and meaner conditions with inside prisons. So we're seeing, in some cases, talking about charging people for toilet paper, reducing the availability of feminine personal products. And one of my, my most distasteful examples is about food. And for anybody who's worked inside prisons, the food is pretty awful. And the Prison Policies Initiative just recently did a study about food in prisons, documenting how many people are hungry, the type of food. But what we're seeing is a number of states are saying, okay, we're going to reduce the meals on the weekends from 3 to 2 for people who are incarcerated. And as I said, in Texas, people who are incarcerated are just like the rest of us. They like brunch on the weekends. And so we're going to just give them 2 meals, right? And they say this stuff, right? And what most of us don't eat like white bread with mystery meat and a slab of cheese, and maybe have that at 6 o'clock in the morning, and then something else at 4 o'clock, and that's going to sustain us on the weekends, right? That's not our brunch, but a number of states are cutting back on meals that way. So what we've seen, and the final piece of emphasizing the economic, is that it's feeding into this kind of idea that prisons and jails are revenue centers, this kind of pay-as-you-go mentality which gave us Ferguson, right? That we're going to give people tickets, we're going to arrest them, we're going to lay fiscal penalties on them in order to pay our police department or pay our prosecutors because we've had cutbacks in our municipal budget. And so what we're seeing is this push for the increased privatization of parole, privatization of probation, that we can load it off onto the private sector, we can have people have to pay more fees and fines, we ladle all those fees and fines on them, once they can't pay them, then we bump them into the prison or into the jail. The other piece of, that's wrong with the kind of elite coalition is it emphasizes three things: justice reinvestment, recidivism rates, and reentry. So justice reinvestment sounds like a beautiful idea, to quote our president, right? Really beautiful. And if the idea is we cut back on what we're spending on prisons and jails, and we shift that money over to the communities that have been most hurt by high levels of violence and crime. But the problem is in that this elite coalition consciously is disenfranchising, keeping those people out of the table, off, away from the table. So when we get buy-in from police and prosecutors for justice reinvestment, the research shows the savings are going to police and prosecutors. They're not going back to those local communities. So in order to get police and prosecutors to do this, we're giving them the savings back, which then gives them more capacity to make mischief with the community. The emphasis on reentry, and I talk a lot about this in my book, focuses on this individual strategy to change, right? That we have to take care of people who are coming out, make them successful citizens to desist from crime. But it defies the iron law of prisons. And the iron law of prisons is if you want to reduce the incarceration rate, you have to send fewer people to prison, you have to keep them there for less amount of time. And the most compelling research is quite convincing that the biggest determinant of who makes a successful reentry and desists is what human capital they have going in, what their socioeconomic level is, what their education level is, what their family connections, whether they're employed or not. As Bruce Western and others have shown us, prison and jail is profoundly damaging. We are very lucky if we could get somebody back to where they started, right? And the best reentry programs that are very expensive, they're hard to take up to scale beyond the smallness of what they are, they only reduce the crime rate by about 15 or 20%. So it doesn't matter whether you're here, you're in Britain, wherever. So to have this idea that we're going to have this really great programming in prisons that then is going to reduce crime and reduce recidivism afterwards is unrealistic. And the other piece of it is it misses the big picture. And the big picture is we have people in prison, and we say, okay, if you just work on your resume, if you just get your font right, if you just do the anger management programs, you get all those individual human skills right, then you can go out and get a job. And it ignores the fact, like in my city in Philadelphia, people going out into communities with 40 or 50% unemployment rate. So that, you know, to say get your anger management under control, when I did everything right in prison, I did all the programming, and now I can't get a job, and also I have on my shoulder the criminal record that I carry around. And as Michelle Alexander says, the big F, my felon F, that's going to be on my forehead. The final part of this relates to recidivism, because we measure whether we're working or not by whether people recidivate when they get out. And we have this, it's kind of almost, you know, etched in stone there, that two-thirds of the people coming out recidivate after 3 years because of the big DOJ, within 3 years, because of the big DOJ study. The fact is, we don't have a good definition of what recidivism is. We've got like 9 different ones. Sometimes it just means getting arrested. And it creates the idea that all these people are doing a major crime and sending them back in. Sometimes they're sent back in for a parole violation. Sometimes they're sent back in for very minor things. In fact, most of the time, they're sent back in for something minor. And it also creates the idea that these 700,000 people coming out of prison and jail every year are wreaking havoc on society and driving the crime rate. And if you actually look at the data about what drives the crime rate, most of the crime is not done by people who are coming out of prison. So this idea that if we could just do reentry right, reduce the recidivism rate, we're going to have a big impact in reducing the crime rate is not correct. And for any of you who study crime goes up and down. We can tell over long periods of time what drives crime rates. Over short periods of time, 3, 4, 5 years, it's not always obvious to say, I say that. If crime starts going up again, then I worry we're going to have a backlash. People are going to say, oh, we did all this recidivism stuff, we did all this reentry and this programming, our crime rate has gone up, nothing works, so all we can do is warehouse people. And the final piece, and this is something I think is so ignored when we talk about the cost of prison is why do we reduce it to, we only care about these people whether they recidivate or not. And we ignore, and there's not a whole lot of research on it, but what we do know is when people come out of prison, they are at a very, very high risk of death. That within the first 2 weeks, everything being equal, controlling for the population, age, et cetera, they have a 13 times higher rate of dying just in those first 2 weeks. Their likelihood of overdosing, not dying, but overdosing is about 129 times higher than the general population. And what we know from other studies is that their overall life expectancy is going to be lower because you've served time in prison. And so just talking about recidivism minimizes those dramatic human costs. I mean, if every judge had to think, okay, I send this person to prison, and when he or she gets out during those first 2 weeks, they have a 13 times higher chance of dying. I might think twice about that. Instead, we think, oh, are they going to commit another crime or not? The other couple of things wrong with this approach is, as I said earlier, it emphasizes the non-non-nons, the non-violent, non-serious, non-sexual offenders. And the fact is that these are a category of offenders that don't really exist. That if you took all the drug offenders out of prison today, it would only reduce state prison populations by about 16%. And if you were only taking out drug offenders who had no kind of violent anything on their records, it would be about 6% of the prison population. Or John Pfaff from Fordham, his new data is actually saying it may only be 1 or 2%. So if we're looking for these pristine people who have nothing on their thing except like a drug possession or low-level dealing, no carrying a gun, no violence, those people don't exist. And so if we want to reduce the prison population, we have to talk about people who've committed some serious crime, some violent crime, but may no longer be violent threats to society. The other piece of this is that the right of crime people so much made this fiscal argument that they never challenged the law and order rhetoric that gave us mass incarceration in the first place. So when that stuff came roaring back with the Trump campaign, and let's be fair, it was also some of the other Republican candidates, there was nothing to come back at it, right? There was no other argument except that, well, we'll save money if we reduce prisons. That's not very powerful against this rhetoric talking about carnage and about the Ferguson effect and that police are afraid and so crime is going up in many, many, many communities. And we had no coming back with a kind of social justice, human rights framework to counter what was going on. And I think that's one of the reasons that the Trump rhetoric and the rhetoric of the surrogates could take off so much. The fiscal argument has also been incapable of addressing the big economic interests that there are in maintaining prisons and jails today. And I want to be very clear, I'm not a believer in the prison industrial complex being the birther of mass incarceration. In my other book, Prison and the Gallows, I went back. It's very hard to find economic interests that created this in the first place. But we have to look at this as a five